river running free. You know how I feel. Blossom on the tree. You know how I feel. It's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good.
Let me welcome you to part three in our series, Quitting for Good. Now, if you haven't been a part of this series, let me catch you up for a moment because it seems kind of counterintuitive. For most of us, quitting is like this bad word, like winners never quit, because if you quit, you lose. But let me tell you something. People who are the best at anything are the best at quitting the right things. In the right ways. What I mean is, people who excel are people who quit things that aren't the best for them, that keep them from the best. They have to quit things to be able to make room for going after the best things and the right things. And that's what quitting for good is really all about. It doesn't mean we aren't persistent. It doesn't mean we don't go for it. It just means if anyone tells you you can have it all, they're not telling you the truth. Some things you have to say no to say yes to others, and that's quitting for good. Now, if you were here like 2 weeks ago in part two of this series, we talked about strategic quitters, people that quit things that aren't the best or beneficial so they can go after the best and the most beneficial. And they ask themselves some very strategic questions. And in fact, there are three of them, and I want to share them one more time with you. Strategic quitters ask these three questions. What am I doing now? Okay? In every key area of your life, in my relationships, with my money, with my health, with my spiritual life, what am I doing now? The second question, what do I need to be doing now? I mean, what do I need to do now to be the person I want to be, to experience the life that I want to experience, the level that I want to experience? But then they ask a third question. The third question is, what do I need to quit doing now in order to do what I need to be doing now? Because we don't have the time, the space, the bandwidth to do everything. So what do I need to quit doing now so I can do now what I really need to be doing now? And that's what this series is really all about. Part one, we talked about the fact that you and I need to quit playing God. And we do that in a variety of ways, and it hurts us and keeps us from experiencing God and the life he has for us. Part two, we talked about, we need to quit hurrying. How many of you have been working on that one? I want to thank all of you who've been helping me with that by driving so slowly. Some of you are like, let's go, let's go, let's go. And all the lines I've been in, like, God has been working on this quit hurrying thing in my life. And so we talked about that in part two. And how you and I can live so fast, we can miss life while we're living it. Now, this weekend in part three, we're gonna talk about another major area that we need to quit. And it's this, you see in your notes, we need to quit complaining. Now, let me set up where we're going with the story. A number of years ago, when I pastored in Pennsylvania, the minister of music that I had been a Benedictine monk. He looked like a monk. He had this bald spot on top. And he was just, and he told me these monk jokes. Okay, not a lot of them, but there was this joke or story of a new monk, and he joined a new monastery. And to join the monastery, you had to take a vow of silence. You could only say two words every year. That was it. And so at the end of the first year, he comes to the abbot, who's the head of the monastery, and he can say two words, and he says, bad food. Another year goes by, his second year. He approaches the abbot, his annual review, and he says, hard bed. Oh, another year goes by. Third year, he comes to the abbot, he goes, I'm leaving. And the abbot said, you may as well, you've done nothing but complain since you got here. Okay, it's not a great, don't complain about my joke. So that's the only story I had. Here's my question for you. Okay, here's a real question. How many times a day do you think the average person in a conversation complains? Okay, just take a guess. The average person has a conversation per day. How many times does the average person complain? Well, there are people that study that. There are behaviors. And here's what they found. The average person in the average conversation complains per day between 15 and 30 times. But the average person in the conversations they have with themselves, called self-talk, complain about once a minute. I mean, like, our self-talk is often so negative, and it's so complaining. It is something that's actually a part. Now, listen, let's get honest, be truthful. When you came in today, like some of you always scout, you grab the program, you looked at what's he going to talk about. Oh, complaining. How many of you complain inwardly when you saw that I'm going to talk about complaining? Some of you complain outwardly. Like, what a week to show up. Like, who wants to go to church? Who wants to get up, drive, to hear a sermon on complaining? I'll tell you who. The person who wants to excel in life, in marriage, in their family, in every area of life. The person who wants to excel. Because here's what behavioral scientists, as well as the Bible, tells us. That people who want to achieve can't do everything and achieve. They've got to quit some things to go after the best things. And one of the things that people who achieve quit on is they quit on complaining. The Bible challenges, watch, Paul makes a statement, and I'm gonna take a wild guess, that almost none of us have memorized this verse. Like, there's a lot of verses you memorize. Like, when I was a kid, I memorized verses for contests and candy bars and all kinds of stuff. I never memorized this verse as a kid. It's Philippians 2, on the screen, Philippians 2, verse 14. In fact, I want you to say it out loud with me because I don't think most of you have memorized this. All right, out loud with your voices, no complaints, okay, out loud. Do everything without complaining. Okay, I'm going to memorize that verse. Like, that is not on my memory list. But if I want to succeed, it should be. Because again, the Bible, as well as science and those who study behavior, tell us that one of the keys to a successful life is to quit complaining. Why? Well, let me give you one of the first reasons. It's in your notes. One of the first things I want you to write down in your notes is simply this. We need to quit complaining because it's very damaging. I want you to write the word damaging. Now, honestly, most of us, come on, complaining, like, it's a bad habit, but it's not that big a deal. Wrong. I mean, it is a bad habit, okay? Complaining can definitely become habitual. And what I mean by that is neurologists, those who study the brain, and now with all the brain scans they can do, they can watch parts of the brain light up, and they figured out all kinds of things about our thinking patterns, and I'm fascinated by how our brains work. And one of the things that your brain does and my brain does is it tries to be efficient, okay? Our brain, here's what like a first year neurology student learns, that synapses that fire together wire together. Synapses are like these connections in our brain of thoughts and patterns and behaviors. They fire together, then they wire together. Our brain looks for ways to be efficient so you don't have to keep learning the same thing over and over. When you finally learn to tie your shoes, there's a path, your brain, it's like automatic. You think about it, but not really consciously, so you don't have to stop every time. Now, the rabbit goes around the tree and through the hole. It's like you don't have to do that because you got it. So what happens to us is we make positive habits that help us be more efficient with our brains, but it also works with negative habits. That you and I can complain so many times that complaining snaps us fire together and then wire together. Let me give you an example. Like on my smartphone, if I go to the Google page and I start to type like a sports site or a news site, it automatically pops up because those are the ones I've gone to many times and it jumps there for me. Your brain and mine does something very similar. But I want to tell you something about the fact. So what I mean is, once you and I complain and complain, our brains create this path. I just started and my brain goes right to the complaints. But that is so much more than simply a pattern or bad habit. It is literally a destructive habit on multiple levels. In your notes, I want you to write this, and it seems very simple, but please, please write this down, that complaining hurts us physically. It really does. Again, researchers from Stanford suggest that complaining can lead to brain damage. Here's what some suggested studies have concluded, that chronic complaining can shrink the hippocampus. It's a part of the brain that's critical to problem solving. It's critical to creative thinking. It's critical to intelligent thought. In fact, constant complaining works on a part of the brain and kind of shuts down a part of the brain that's actually impaired by Alzheimer's, same area. That constant complaining can actually hurt our brain. But not just our brain, our body. One of the hormones our body produces when we're stressed is called cortisol. Now, there are some positives to cortisol. It raises your blood sugar level. It raises your heartbeat, all the kind of things. It helps us when we're stressed to fight or run. It's kind of a survival hormone. But too much of it, or living in that constant state, is very bad for us. Too much cortisol in our system can elevate our blood pressure, our blood sugar. It can hurt our immune system, makes us more susceptible to high cholesterol, diabetes, weight problems, heart disease, even strokes. And here's the connection. People that complain constantly are stressed constantly. People that are constantly complaining, they're stressed about something, and that stress just jacks our cortisol levels. And so it hurts us brain-wise, it hurts us body-wise, but here's the second thing in your notes to write. Second thing is simply that complaining hurts us relationally. All right, let's get real. How many of you just love to hang out with chronic complainers? How many say, man, I can't wait to go to work because the person beside me, they just complain all day long. It is so much fun. No, let me tell you something about complainers. Complainers don't even like to hang out with complainers because they don't want to hear them. They want to share them. They don't want to hear somebody else's complaint. I want you to hear mine. And one of the reasons it hurts relationships, listen carefully, is complaining is contagious. It really is. Scientifically, it's contagious. It's called neural mirroring. Neural mirroring is simply, and it's been studied and proven, if you sit with someone, sit across from them, whoever you're closest to for the longest amount of time, you will start to mirror them. In fact, in one sense, it's a gift. It's how we empathize. To empathize is to feel what someone's feeling and to dial in with them, and they're sad, and then we get sad because they're sad, and that's how we empathize. And so that can be a positive, but it can be negative if what we're empathizing with is dangerous. If it's complaining. In fact, we can start complaining because somebody else is complaining, but more than that, this is what I found really interesting. Even if you're with someone and they're complaining and you don't complain, it can still impact you. Here's what a doctor who studies it, Dr. Travis Bradbury, writes. Listen, this is really interesting. He says, think of it this way. If a person were smoking, would you sit there all afternoon inhaling the secondhand smoke? No, you distance yourself, and you should do the same with complainers. He says there's such a thing as secondhand complaining. That you can sit with someone. Now, again, I've been people and they smoke and they blow the smoke the other way. Complainers don't turn to blow the smoke, they complain at you. And after a while, it gets to you. And it can impact you even when you're not the one complaining. Even if you don't join in, you're breathing the stuff. And you're starting to experience the negative of complaining. But perhaps the most devastating aspect of complaining is a third thing I want you to write in your notes, that complaining hurts us spiritually. I want to show you out of Scripture a lot of passages, but here's one, Numbers 11, verse 1. And soon the Israelites began to, say it out loud, complain about their hardship. And watch this, the Lord heard everything they said. Moses, verse 10, heard all the family standing in the doorways of their tents. Don't miss that phrase, I'll come back to it. Not only that they were complaining, but where they were complaining, in the doorways of their tents, in where they lived, whining. And the Lord became extremely angry. Moses was also very aggravated. an entire generation of Israelites, listen carefully because this is really, really important. An entire generation of Israelites missed out on the promised land and future God had for them because they complained themselves right out of it. What do they complain about? Anything and everything. They complained about the menu. They were hungry, and God gave them what's called manna, manna from heaven every day. And manna, the Hebrew word means, what is it? They ate, what is it, for 40 years. I ate, what is it, for 4 years in college. What is it? We called it mystery meat because we had no idea what it was. They said it was meat, but I don't think so. But they ate manna. They complained about manna. They complained about thirsty. They complained about, oh, that we could go back to Egypt. Now, they were slaves in Egypt, and they were punished. But, oh, everything was free there. Yeah, right. And we had meat. Their memories were really messed up. Complaining distorts the past and the present and the future. They complained about anything and everything. And again, so what? Here's what's so sobering to me. Here's why this is so important. Is the Bible tells us that what happened to them can happen to us. That we can forfeit the amazing promises and future God has for us. And Paul is point blank about it. Watch this. He writes this in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1. I don't want you to forget, dear brothers and sisters, about our ancestors in the wilderness long ago, the Israelites we just read about. All of them were guided by a cloud that moved ahead of them, and all of them walked through the sea on dry ground. They experienced the miraculous. All of them ate the same spiritual food, and all of them drank the same spiritual water, for they drank from the spiritual rock that traveled with them. That rock was Christ. It wasn't just a rock that water came out of. It was a symbol of God providing. Jesus said, if you're thirsty, come see me. Verse 5, yet God was not pleased with most of them, and their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Jump to verse 10. Don't grumble. Complain, as some of them did, and then were destroyed by the angel of death. These things happened to them as examples for who? See, Paul says, listen, in this passage, it's so easy to read the first part. He goes like, don't sexual immorality. But Paul says that grumbling was at the heart of them being destroyed. And so don't forget, he says, learn from their lives. Now, let's get real for a moment. To say, quit complaining, does that mean that we never say anything about our frustrations or irritations? Does that mean that we can never say anything about our struggles with people or even the issues we have with God? To quit complaining, does that mean we never verbally question, speak up about pain, injustice, delays, or taxes? No. It's not what it means when the Bible says quit complaining. It doesn't mean suck it up and stuff a sock in your mouth and never verbalize anything that's painful, difficult, frustrating. In fact, the opposite. God actually encourages us to verbalize and vocalize and share, to confront, which means, see, many people, confrontation's negative, but confronting simply means face-to-face, and God invites us to face-to-face time with him, face-to-face time with others. He challenges us not to shut up, but to speak up, but in a very special way with him and with others. In fact, Scripture teaches us to do something. Anybody here a Popeye fan? Anybody here grew up with Popeye? Three of us, okay? Like you have to Google it. But when Popeye finally had it, anybody remember what Popeye would say? I can't stand it. Remember what he said? Anybody? I can't stand, that's all I can stand. I can't stand it no more. And the Bible says when you can't stand it no more, here's what I want you to do. I want you to write it down. It's the second thing in your notes. When you can't stand it no more, here's what the Bible says. We need to stop grumbling and start groaning. I want you to write the word groaning. There's an Old Testament scholar, theologian, professor. His name is Tremper Longman. He wrote an article that honestly just really captured me. It's an amazing article that encourages us to groan. And the article simply titled, Getting Brutally Honest with God. And in this article, he writes that there's a major difference between grumbling and groaning. Listen carefully. He writes, when we groan, we cry out to God. Groaning can be an act of intimacy, an opportunity to speak directly to God, not behind his back. The Psalms of lament, or Psalms expressing pain, confusion, and struggles, are an example of this. They give us permission to complain to God and invite us to speak to him with utter honesty. Grumbling, on the other hand, is complaining about God behind his back, as if that were possible. The Israelites grumbled in the wilderness. The psalmist groaned in the presence of God. Do you see the difference? The difference is big. Grumbling is about God. I told you earlier, they grumbled in their tents. There was a tent of meetings with God. They didn't grumble there. They didn't grumble in God's presence. They grumbled sideways. They grumbled in their houses. They grumbled in their cars. They grumbled as if they could grumble behind God's back. There, it was sideways complaining. And the Bible says God got ticked with them. That God is not a big fan of sideways because it's accusations and it's a lack of trust and it's blaming. How many know to blame is to be lame? I gotta blame someone. God, why'd you do this to me? And they took it sideways. But the Bible also says that groaning is taking our complaints to God. And that directional difference makes all the difference. Let me show you from Scripture. Watch this. Exodus 2, verse 23. And the Israelites groaned, there's that word, under their slavery and cried out. Their cries for relief, watch this, watch the direction, ascended. That's up to God. God listened to their groanings. Now, he got ticked off by their grumblings, but he listened to their groanings. God understood. In fact, let me go farther, because it's such an interesting study, groanings, that God not only listens to groanings and God not only understands groanings that are brought to him, God helps us to groan. Watch this, Romans 8, verse 26. Paul writes, the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness, in our struggles. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for, but the Holy Spirit, God himself, prays for us with what? No, just stop here for a moment. The Holy Spirit actually groans in us and for us and with us that cannot be expressed in words. Come on, have you ever had times in which you couldn't even verbalize because you couldn't even figure it out? How many of you have ever just gone, ugh, just says it all. Like, I can't. And this is like my pushback for a moment, and I can't go down this path too far, but some people's teaching on prayer is you got to tell God exactly what you want, and if you're not detailed with God, you'll never get it, and you got to give him all the, yeah, some of that may be okay, but a lot of that's not. I'll tell you why it's not, because sometimes I don't know what I need. Sometimes I don't know the best way to pray. Not only for others, but for me. I mean, I pray as thoughtfully and with as much wisdom as I can, but sometimes I'm just stuck. And the Bible says in those moments, because groaning has to do with the inmost desires and struggle and conflicts and questions and fears. And when I take those and I start to groan, God himself, the Holy Spirit, helps me groan to God. In fact, Paul goes on and says this, verse 27, and the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers, in harmonizing, in harmony with God's own will. See, God is not against groaning. In fact, God invites us not to take it sideways in a tent, in a car, but to take it to him. In fact, Lamentations 2, verse 19. Now, let me be real with you. Lamentations is not really an up book. Like, it's not like Red and Weddings. It's like, it's Lamentations. It's kind of a book about Jeremiah's just crying a lot. But watch this. Jeremiah says, Lamentations 2, verse 19, get up and cry out in what? Prayer. Pour your heart out face to face with the Master. See, the Bible doesn't say quit complaining, just suck it up and stuff a sock in it. It says cry out, but cry up. Take it up to God, face to face with God. There isn't anything you and I think, feel, face that God can't handle. Just talk to me about it. Bring it to me. Pour it out to me. Talk to me about it. Cry out to me. I think taking it up includes not only God, but to spiritual wise people in our life. Now, I want to caution you, take it up to the right people, because not everybody can handle our doubts, our concerns, our fears, our struggles. Some people, it blows them away and they can't deal with it. So it's very important. In fact, when Paul writes about people who are qualified to kind of help others in Galatians 6, he talks about you who are spiritual, led by the Spirit, humbly and gently. They have a maturity that they humble themselves. They don't have all the answers and they're gentle in how they deal with others. And so spiritual mature are humble and they're gentle. And then he says, restore gently. It means to put a broken bone in place or to mend a net. It has to do with untangling things that are tangled. And so sometimes we need to take it up to people that are spiritual, led by God, they have the fruit of God in their life. But it is so important that you and I understand the difference between grumbling and groaning is the direction. It's not the content as much as it's the direction. And so God says, don't talk about me behind my back like he already knows. Let's talk about it face to face. Because answers are never found sideways. In fact, I found it really interesting. Again, in studies about complaints, most people don't take their complaint to somebody who can do something about it. Studies show that like, people get ticked off at a restaurant or ticked off at a business. They almost never tell that business, but they tell 25 other people. Now, those other people can't fix what your experience was. If you take it to the right people in the right way, there's a chance some resolution can happen. But we don't tend to take it up. We take it sideways. Because sometimes the best thing, we want everyone else upset too. Which doesn't fix anything. So God says, don't multiply your grumbles. Groan to me. So I got a question for you. Okay, how many of you are ready to stop grumbling and start groaning? Now, how do we do that? Here's the third thing I want you to write in your notes. Here's the third key. To quit complaining, we need a transforming attitude. The word I want you to write is attitude. John Ortberg, pastor, author, he puts it like this. Just listen carefully. There are basically two ways to quit complaining. One of them is to change your external world so there is no circumstance left to complain about. That means if you've been complaining about not being married, you have to get married. If you are married, you have to improve your spouse into the kind of person who would never generate grounds for complaint. If you have a job, you want one of those jobs where your boss asks, "What hours would you like to work? How much money would you like to make?" You have to make sure your commutes to work are always traffic-free. You have to make sure your dates are cute, your grades are A's, and all your relatives are in therapy. That's one way to try to quit complaining. Change your external world. The other way is to change your internal world. To choose and cultivate the kind of inner attitude we need so we can receive every day like it's manna. Like a gift from God. So how do we quit complaining in that second way? Because in the words of Jesus, that first way ain't never gonna happen on this planet. Okay, that's my paraphrase. Jesus didn't use bad English. He spoke in Aramaic and Greek. But here's what Jesus actually said. Okay, just because some of you are looking at me like you're complaining. Okay, here's what he says. John 16, verse 33. Here on what? Earth, you will have what? Many trials and what? So ain't never gonna happen on this planet. That's basically what he says. Now, I can't preach a sermon on this, but Jesus said that first way, if you're waiting to stop complaining because everything around you is perfect, not gonna happen. We live in a broken place, a broken planet with broken people. One day, everything is going to be as God intended it, but not this day. In fact, this day, he says, you will have not just trials, many. And the word trials can also be translated tests, temptations, and many sorrows. There are many pains and goodbyes and wounds that happen in wounded places. Now, this may mess with some of your minds. Some of those happen because of broken people, broken places, broken things, and some of them happen because it's God's plan. But listen, God tested Abraham. The Bible says that some of these hardships that Israel went through, God was testing them. He was trying, they had been 400 years in slavery. And so now God was changing their mindset from being slaves to being children of God. And so he was testing them. Let me try to give you a parallel, because some of you do this. There are some of you people, and you are crazy. Okay, let me just start with that. Because you get up before the sun is up, which is just silly, because that's why you don't get up till the sun's out. But you get up before the sun's out. You drive to a health club, health center, where you pay someone to torture you. You pay for that cycle class. I call it a cycle class. You pay for that cycle class. And that person that's in ungodly shape on the bike, and you're pedaling for all your worth, and you go nowhere. Let's go, class. Where are we going? We're just same place. And you're sweating and you're spinning and you're sweating and you're spinning and you pay for it. And then you can't walk. And you bought it. Now why? Because you know to get in the shape you want, you gotta pay some price. Listen. The reason when you follow Jesus, it doesn't get easier is because he's training you for a godly life in future. And with that comes tests. Don't miss that Jesus begins his ministry by being baptized by John. God speaks from heaven. The Holy Spirit descends like a dove. God speaks and says, this is my son whom I love. I am dearly pleased with him. And what's the first thing he does? The Holy Spirit leads him to tests. He leads him right out into the desert. For 40 days, he's tested. Mano a mano, Satan tests Jesus to us. So if you say, I want to get close to God, and then I start getting tested out of my mind, you're just following Jesus. So Peter writes, don't think something strange happening to you because you're going through fire. So yeah, I know that, listen, sometimes we go, man, I want to get serious with God, and my whole life's falling apart. God is test. So sometimes the world tests us, and people test us, but God, in this world, you will have tests and trials. So the Bible speaks to us about this so you and I can understand this very important concept. So how do we change our inner attitude? Because we can't change our external world. We try. I'm gonna give you a couple things to write down. More than that, I want to give you a couple things that you and I need to live out. Two biblical and practical ways to change and transform our inner world. Because you're not going to change the outer world to perfection in this life. Here's the first. We need to challenge and change our thinking. Thinking's the first word I want you to write. Romans 12, verse 2, Message Bible, don't become so well adjusted, Paul writes, to your culture. We live in a culture of complaining. That you fit into it without even thinking. You just go along. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed, watch this, from the where? Inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you. Quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings out the best of you. And don't miss this phrase, develops well-formed maturity. There's no gift of maturity. You develop maturity in tests and time and trials and struggles and stages. It is so important to understand that I feel the way I feel and I act the way I act because I think the way I think. We many times don't associate our feelings with our thoughts, but they are connected. Because you can have a feeling that's super strong and all of a sudden a thought gets changed and your feelings changes because the feeling was connected to the thought, though we don't always, the feeling's the first thing we're sometimes aware of. And then the behavior, and if I want to change my behavior is tied to my thoughts. So that's why the Bible says, let God change the way you think, because if you transform your thoughts, you'll transform your life. So the Bible challenges us to think differently. Does that mean that we think everything is good when it's not? No, no. It just means I learn how to think God's ways. I need God's perspectives on things. One of my favorite Psalms, it really is, and we just don't have time to read it all today, but you can see in your notes, I give just two of the verses, but I challenge you to read Psalm 73. It's one of those psalms of lament or complaint. It is a psalm of groaning to God. And the psalmist begins with this conclusion, God is good, God can be trusted, but then he tells us how he got to that conclusion. He's very honest. He goes, my feet almost slipped. In other words, spiritually speaking, I just about lost my foothold, my place in God. And here's when it happened. I started looking around. And if you ever look around, and he started saying, this is not right. This is not fair. The ungodly have no problems and the godly have all the problems. Now, it's a bit of an exaggeration, but when you're feeling that way, we exaggerate. Then he says, okay, how many of you, you have ungodly neighbors and they have a better car than you, better house than you, their kids have straight teeth. Okay, it's like, how, this isn't right. And the person who gets the raise, gets the promotion, everybody knows they're a jerk. And he goes, this is just not right. And he went on, and I start looking at all the things that I sacrifice and give up and all the things I've said no to, and they don't give it up and they're doing well and I'm not. What's this all about? And then he says, and if I had said this to others, here's where he's wise. If I'd taken that sideways, I would have discouraged others. So he didn't do that. But he had had it. This is all I can stand. I can stand it no more. Now watch what he writes. Verse 16. When I tried to figure it out, all I got was a splitting headache. Until, verse 17. Until I entered the sanctuary of God, until I brought it to God. And then I saw the whole or big picture. He goes on to say, then I saw the end for those who go their way and not God's way. See, here's the deal. When I take it up, God changes my thinking, because here's what happens to us. When you and I are in frustrating situations and complaints, we zoom in. That is all I can see. It is all I can think about. It is consuming. But when I take it to God, I zoom out. I start to see this as one piece of a much bigger picture. And because it's happening today doesn't mean it's the last word. And because somebody is prospering today who's just turning their back and thumbing God and just doesn't mean that's their final. God is incredibly patient, but it doesn't mean it's the last word for them or for us. And so what you and I do when we bring things to God is we start to get a different perspective, and perspective is a way of thinking that changes everything. So where do you get your perspective? If you get it from the culture around you, you're in trouble. If I get it from the God above me, I start to see things as they are. Does that mean I'll always understand them? No, but it means I start to trust God with the big picture. I don't have time to go further into this, but I believe at the heart of groaning is a distrust of God. And that's why it ticks God off. If you want to make God happy, to please God takes faith. It's impossible to please God without faith. Faith is simply trusting. God says, you can't please me if you don't trust me. And the heart of grumbling is, I don't trust you. I don't trust you with my life. I don't trust you with my future. I don't trust you with the situation. I don't trust you with this problem. I don't trust you. And God says, you'll never please me if you don't trust me. And so I change the way I think when I get God's perspective, when I pray about it through his word, through godly believers. I start to change my perspective. And when I change my perspective, things around me may not change, but I will. Boy, I love this. Paul says, Philippians, don't worry about anything. Yeah, right. But pray about everything. Take it to God. And the God of peace, or divine order, he says, pray about everything with thanksgiving. And the God of peace, divine order, will guard your heart and mind. Doesn't say he'll change everything, but he will guard your life. He will give you a sense of sovereign order in your life, even in the midst of chaos, because your outside may not always be right, but your inside can be. And that's where the complaints stop and the grace and growth start. Now, very important, here's a second key. We not only need to challenge and change our thinking, here's the second. We need to prioritize and practice thanksgiving. I don't mean Turkey Day. Giving thanks. Dr. Robert Emmons and a team of researchers spent 10 years doing an incredible study about the impact and effects of being thankful. He put those 10 years of research into a book, an interesting book simply titled Thanks: How the New Science of Gratitude Can Make You Happier. Here's a part of what he writes. Without gratitude, life can be lonely, depressing, and impoverished. Gratitude enriches human life. It raises levels of alertness, enthusiasm, determination, attentiveness, and energy. The healthiest and happiest people are thankful people. 10 years of research just confirmed what God's words always said. To give thanks is transformational. Now, many of us will give thanks after something good happens. That's not what the Bible says. Paul says, make your requests known to God with thanksgiving. Before anything happens, you thank God that he always hears you, that he's with us, that he can work all things together for good. I thank God for anything good happens, because thanksgiving is transformational. So I start by giving thanks. And when I give thanks, it transforms me. But let me tell you something about being a thanksgiver. It is not natural. We are natural grumblers. We are natural cynics. We are natural. Now, some of you are by nature more positive than others, but that's not in our nature. Nobody drifts to being thankful. We prioritize it and we practice it. And I want to give you just three quick best practices for being thankful. Now, it's not in your notes because I knew you'd grumble if you had to write more, so it's not there. Let me give you just three quick statements from those who study the science of gratitude. Here's one. Keep a thankfulness journal for 2 weeks. Just 2 weeks, 14 days. Just from this Sunday to 2 weeks from now. And here's what Dr. Emmons did with a group of people. He did this thankfulness group for 2 weeks, 14 days. He had them write 5 things a day for 14 days that they were thankful for. Just 5 things. Before they went to bed, first thing in the morning, just on your phone, on a notepad, just for 14 days, just write down 5 things you are thankful for. And at the end of 14 days, the group that they did this with, their happiness, their thankfulness level went up 25%. From what they said they were before, their happiness level went up 25% because they became good finders instead of bad finders, because you find what you look for. You find the synapses that fire together, wire together. And if I change my synapses that I'm looking for good things, it starts to build things, and I start looking for different things in my life. Here's a second. Send a thank you letter. Make a thank you call. Schedule a personal thank you appointment. The Apostle Paul was amazing at this. He's the one who wrote "Don't Complain About Anything," and he wrote that from prison. He said, how could he do that? Because he was a thanksgiver. Watch this. He writes to the Philippian believers, Philippians 1 verse 3, every time I think of you, I give thanks to my God. He writes to his spiritual son Timothy, 2 Timothy 1 verse 3, Timothy, I thank God for you. Night and day I remember you in my prayers. He writes to his good friend Philemon, Philemon 1 verse 4, I always thank my God when I pray for you. So interesting, these are letters. We call them books, but they're letters. And Paul started most of his letters with, thank God for you. When was the last time you verbally thanked someone? See, here's what happens. When we don't verbally express thanks, people read that as ingratitude. So when was the last time you wrote a note, or you called someone up, or you texted them, or you say, hey, I want to meet with you. Now listen, let me just qualify this for a moment. I want to encourage you, don't send a thanks to someone you want something else from. Okay, like you gave me money, here's my new address. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying you thank somebody. You just express appreciation for what someone did in your life. And then let me give you a third one. commit to a 1 week complaining fast. Now, some of us need to start with 1 day. Okay. Some of us need to start with half a day. But we start to rewire our life by, and in fact, in these study groups, one of the things they did was use these people with rubber bands, and they would like snap themselves, or some of you aren't into pain, they would just move it from one hand to the next time. Every time they complained, to remind themselves to stop complaining, they were always doing this all day long. But they were starting to rewire. No, they were starting to detox themselves. Because complaining is toxic. And a complaining fast will detox my mind and my spirit from an attitude and action that will destroy my life. So one more time, put the verse back on the screen, because you memorized this from a few moments ago. Paul writes in Philippians 2, verse 14, I want you to say this without complaining out loud, okay? Everyone out loud. Do everything without complaining. Why? Because it's destructive. Physically, relationally, emotionally, it does a number on us. It doesn't mean I don't ever speak about it. It's just I take it up. I don't grumble sideways. I groan upwards. God invites us to talk. There's nothing you feel, think that God can't handle and help us handle, but we got to take it up. So the Bible doesn't say stuff it, ignore it. It says groan about it. In fact, God says, I will help you groan to me about it. And then the third key is we need to transform our attitude, because you can't transform an imperfect world. That doesn't mean we aren't to help it, do the best with it. But if you're waiting to stop grumbling for everything to be perfect, it's not gonna happen. But you and I can work on the inside of us by thinking new thoughts and by becoming thanks givers. And when that happens, when I quit complaining, I make room to go after the life that is really life. Let's pray. God, help us. God, honestly, we don't even see ourselves as complainers. We don't see that. But you do. And you challenge us to quit because it's keeping us from the promises and purposes, the life that we'll never experience if we don't quit what's not good so we can go after what is. So our minds can be filled with what is good, perfect, pleasing, pure, right, praiseworthy, because our mind's not filled with grumbling and whining and fault-finding and blaming. If you're here today and you've never crossed the line of faith, that's where it starts. So right where you sit, you can pray, Jesus, forgive me of my sin, my acts of being God of my own life, and I want to follow you with my whole heart, as you empower me with your grace and your Holy Spirit.